So everything culminates in an analytical package. And this package really serves two purposes. One, it helps you keep track of your data. I can assure you that in a facility like ours, we deal with a lot of projects. And to have your information in a common place, whether it's in files online or it's literal paperwork, you want to keep track of what you have. That may sound obvious, and it's good housekeeping. But it also serves a purpose for regulatory submission time. So whenever it's necessary, you could channel that off. In our case, where we are contracted out for a lot of work, we may not always be like there for the whole project. But certainly enough, our methods, our validations, our stability, and so on, do get put into those submissions. So that might be mediated by someone who's not at Regis, but it's done by somebody. In that analytical package, we want to have all the proper data, ID, physical characterization, purity data, impurity data. We want to have an idea of lot history and to perform the appropriate comparisons. I'm going to have a slide on that really shortly. Method development reports. I cannot tell you how valuable these are. They are deliverables in our business to give to the customer when we finish a method development job. But also, they're great reminders of what was done in the method development when we have to troubleshoot. We hope to never have those kind of problems, but occasionally questions come up, and they're very handy. You should also have information on references or reference standards, and where appropriate, stability data. I put this slide in just to help people keep in mind that there's an ultimate documentation target. I'm not going to do a deep dive into this, but there is a chemistry, manufacturing, and controls document that is involved when you're doing an IND or NDA submission. And for analytical development, there is an explanation of methodology. But there's no requirement to really go into it real deep, but you need to just give enough information to describe what it is you did. And there may be a place for validation data or verification data and so on. And a good analytical package prepared in advance makes all that go easier. I'm going to talk a little bit more about this package topic, and I want to mention lot history for impurities. It's important to track impurities for your drug substance across lots. And the best way to do that, it should be obvious, but to compare them in a single run. Look for similarities in retention time, UV spectra, mass spectra. Now, you may have to tailor this for the method you're working with, and I'm giving an example that pertains to HPLC. And I'm going to actually give an example here in a table. Once again, this is not a vision test, but you do have notes, and it's the spirit of what we're trying to do here. In this table across the top, we have retention times of various impurities in a certain material. And the first lot, which is the second line on there, shows that it's a fairly impure material with about 8 or so impurities present. So this customer wanted to know, as they did continued manufacturing, and they came across a third lot here called plant lot number 3, they wanted to know if those impurities were the same as any of the ones they saw in their toxicology lot, that second line, right? So you could imagine the question is my 8-minute impurity seen on this analysis with this lot the same as my 8-minute impurity with that analysis on that lot? And there's always between run variability, so you can question, well, you're not really sure until you do the matchup. So it's not rocket science, it's just good organization, it's pattern recognition. And what we had done here, again, it is a busy slide, and the spirit of this is what's important, okay? We actually looked at matching for UV spectra. We looked at matching for retention time. We also looked at matching for primary ion, primary M plus 1 ion in mass spec mode. So this was a mass spec friendly method, by the way. And we focused even further on just one of the impurities and did limited fragmentation studies. And that is enough to give you a good sense of confidence that if an impurity has this unique like fingerprint of characteristics, and that one has that, then there's a match. And so that's what the customer was looking for in this case. So we helped define that. I'm sure that anybody involved in impurities knows about this guideline. Most of us tend to focus on the middle row, which is for dosing less than or equal to 2 grams a day. But there are reporting, ID, and qualification thresholds for impurities. So this is always center stage when you're manufacturing and you create a new impurity that you didn't see before, or maybe you have more of a certain impurity that you have seen before, but now what is the level? How concerned do I need to be? So this is a reporting threshold at 0.05. There's an ID threshold, and qualification is the one that gets serious, because when you get into the qualification arena, that means tox studies, time, money. As a contract manufacturer, I'm sure people can appreciate that when we're in a campaign and we're making material that someone else might have made before, and then we would be the ones to have a higher level impurity, we can't just dismiss it. We need to really figure out what's the strategy behind that. And of course, the strategy is to do your process development well so that you avoid that in the first place. But it can happen. It's just the reality of manufacturing. So I put this slide together about knowing your impurities. To me, it's always like it's in my mental folders, and I think about how it really overlaps with the analytical package idea as well. But we all know you have your well-known impurities like chromatographic base, residual solvents, water, ROI, and metals. It's good to always think about what do you do when you have new impurities or you see degradation products in a stability study. So your organization should have an SOP or guideline for how you handle that. And thinking more tactically, you may need to synthesize impurities to characterize, and you may need to make reference standards of them. So it's like any good program. As the project evolves, you can't just say, well, that's a relative retention time 2.0 impurity, and we'll collect the data on it. You've got to know it better and better as the project goes along. Keep in mind response factors. Something can look like a small impurity, but because of response factor differences from the parent, your area percent number might be completely unreliable. We need to maximize identification techniques for elucidating the structure of that impurity, such as with NMR, high resolution, mass spec, and so on. And we always keep in mind the guidelines. And my last line there is just that where appropriate, it could be highly useful to get a virtual-based identification or characterization, and let me call that characterization, of a material where if you have where you're looking for alerting structures for toxicology concern, or you're just simply trying to gather information. I'm going to talk more about that topic in a future slide. But again, this is a thought list as I see it, and it's something that every cGMP facility should be paying attention to. So here is that slide on potentially genotoxic impurities. This is a hot topic, and people give like hour or longer webinars, seminars on this topic. There are symposia around it. I'm going to try to condense this into one or two slides. But when we think about those impurity limits, such as with ICH, the classic ICH impurity table, where 0.1% is the ID threshold and so on, potentially genotoxic impurities represent a class that generally requires a lot more strict control. Because they could be more toxic, your limits could have to be set significantly lower. From our own experience, we've had to update methodologies to take us to about 1,000-fold lower than the classic limit, okay? There are regulatory guidelines available for this. There's something from the FDA, the ICH, and so on. I'll flash a couple of those slides shortly. There is a justification through toxicology prediction software that examines structure-activity relationships. There are computer programs available where you input the compound and the software looks for alerting groups such as sulfonic acid esters, anilines, aromines. There's a host of them that are definite flags. It doesn't mean your impurity is toxic, but you're pretty much accountable for showing how toxic it might be. And again, could it be through testing, with Ames testing, isolating the impurity? Can it be through just making sure that you're always having less than a certain limit, which is much stricter, I'll show that shortly, so you goose up your method so that it's more sensitive? And you may justify through the software that maybe this is not such a problem. Determining limits is challenging. I was talking with a consultant in the industry who said, in spite of these different guidelines, you still have to deal with your own compound. This is a table that basically shows, and it's from the FDA database, that for a drug that's going to be more chronically given as going left to right, your allowed micrograms per day of that impurity will be going down. So when the allowed impurity amount goes down, it means your methods have to be more sensitive. And it's also fair to say that projects for which this didn't matter, and like let's say 5 years ago, it matters now. And we have had a commercial product longstanding by which we've always been aware of a certain impurity. We knocked it down to really low levels just out of good process chemistry. And a regulatory agency, or I should say within an audit, we were told that this could flag as a potentially genotoxic impurity. So we performed method development and made our method more sensitive, showing that we could see really low levels now. And in fact, on testing, we were at less than those really low levels. And that was a good thing. But so we got hit with that stick, even though we thought maybe we were grandfathered in. Or again, you must understand how this evolves. The industry is getting more careful, and so they're asking more and more each day. So that is one example of a document, and this is another. Again, I just put these little snippets here, and people can go and read these as you like. M7 is a relatively new guideline. I myself know that I need to read it really more carefully. It's pretty long, but it does represent the ICH perspective.
Where does M7 come from? Is that an ICH document?
It is. It's under the multi-purpose?
Miscellaneous.
Thanks.
Okay, good.
Thanks, Mike. And there's also a whole guideline and topic for residual solvent analysis. Again, it's limit-based, and those limits are in proportion to assumed maximum dosing, such as 10 grams a day. Most of our customers simply ask for the ICH limits at any time in their project because I think maybe because they represent what is perceived as good limits, and aesthetically, even though you might say my drug is only going to be 10 milligrams and I could get a lot more heptanes in there, well, I think there can be problems with processing for drug product work as well as, again, aesthetics. So but technically and mathematically, you can almost make a slurry in solvent as long as you keep in mind all the guidelines, right? And I'm saying that with sort of a sarcasm.